We will start our problem with a square. Then, inside the square, we will put another small square, which we're going to tilt and move so that the bottom right vertices of both squares are touching, as you can see on the sketch. Now, let's pull a line which connects the top right vertices of both squares, and let's say that this line has the length of 1. Now, the question is, can we somehow find the length of the line which connects the top left vertices of those two squares? This interesting problem was sent to me by an email by one of my subscribers, Thomas from London. So thank you, Thomas, for this wonderful suggestion. Of course, if you guys want to try this one out for yourself, this would be a great time to pause the video, try it out, and then come back and check the solution. All right, so let's solve this one together. I'm going to show you three different methods of solving this problem, and for the last method, you're only going to need a couple of seconds. But before we get to that, I will first show you the classical geometry approach to this problem. So, we're going to start by labeling all the vertices of our big square as A, B, C, and D, and the remaining vertices of the small square as E, F, and G. Now, let's have a look at the line EF, which is the side of our smaller square, and let's label it as A. From the point C, we will construct a parallel line to the line EF. Now, let's have a look at the line EC. It has the length of 1, and we're going to take this line and slide it to the left along those two parallel lines which we constructed, and we're going to label its intersection point with the upper line as O. Now, since the line EC is, of course, parallel to the line FO, we can conclude that the line OC also has the length of A. This means that our newly formed quadrilateral FECO is actually a parallelogram, and we're going to use that fact later. Now let's have a look at the acute angle EBC and let's label it as theta. And let's also notice the angle FEB, which is the angle of the square, so it must be 90 degree angle. Now, if we were to extend the line BE to the line OC and label this intersection point as P, we can easily conclude that the angle at the point P must be right angle as well. Of course, this is due to the fact that the line FE is parallel to the line OC. Now, let's have a look at the right angle triangle which we just constructed, the triangle PBC. Since it has the angles of theta and 90 degrees, this means that the remaining acute angle at the point C of this triangle must be 90 degrees minus theta. So now, finally, let's have a look at the overall angle at the point C, or the angle DCB, if you like. This is also the angle of the square, so it must be 90 degree angle. So, with this in mind, we can easily conclude that the remaining angle OCD of this 90 degree angle must be equal to theta. All right, so now let's continue with our construction. We will now pull a line from the point O to the point D, and in this way we will form this nice triangle DCO. And let's also have a look at the triangle BCE. Let's try to prove that those two triangles are congruent. First, let's have a look at the line FE. It has the length of A, but since this is the side of the square as well as the line EB, this means that the line EB must also have the length of A. Next, we already proved that OC is equal to FE, so this means that the line OC and the line EB are both equal. Next, we know the fact that the angles EBC and OCD are equal. We have proven that earlier. And finally, if you take a look at the side DC and label it as B, you can see that it is equal to the side CB, since both of them are the sides of the same square. Now, by using side-angle-side theorem, we have a firm proof that the triangles BCE and CDO are actually congruent. From this, we will learn two important facts, which are going to help us to solve our problem. The first fact is that the line EC must be equal to the line OD, which also has the length of 1. And the second is that angles at the point E and the point O of our two triangles are also equal. Now, from before, we know that FECO is a parallelogram. And we also know that one of the properties of parallelogram states that the opposite angles are equal. So this means that the angles at the point E and the point O of this parallelogram are actually equal. Now, since the angle FEB is the angle of the square, it is a 90-degree angle, which leads us to conclude that the remaining angle DOF at the point O must be 90-degree angle as well. Alright, so now we can try to find the length of X. And to do this, we will use the triangle DOF. If we isolate this triangle, you can notice that this is an isosceles right triangle with the side of 1. And it represents the half of the square. So X is nothing but the diagonal of the square, which we can calculate as side times square root of 2, and we will get that X is equal to square root of 2, and this is our solution. Alright, so now let me show you the second method, which is going to be faster than this method, and we can do it by noticing some interesting fact. And that fact is that we have a tilted square, but nobody said the angle of the rotation of this square. So we can easily assume that the angle of the rotation is equal to zero. If this is the case, our sketch will look something like this. Now, if we label the side of our big square as S, and notice that the segment on the top right of this square is now equal to 1, this means that the remaining segment on the bottom right must be equal to the difference between those two, or S minus 1. And you can notice that we got the side of our small square. So if you take a look at the line X, you can see that it actually represents the part of the diagonal. And we can get this length as the difference between the length of the diagonals of our big and our small square. So our big square has the diagonal of side times square root of 2 and the small square as well. Only the side of the small square is S minus 1, as we already calculated. So now, we can just substitute those two values in our first equation, we will expand it, then we can simplify S square root of 2, and we will get that X must be equal to square root of 2, and again, we have the same solution. Now, let me show you the fastest method of all, and the method which you are going to solve in only a couple of seconds if you know how to think about this problem, which I'm going to show you right now. Like I said in the previous problem, nobody told us the angle of the rotation of the small square. But they also didn't tell us the dimensions of the small square. So, let's assume that the dimensions of the small square are non-existing, that the small square has the side of zero. If this is the case, we will get the following image. Now you can see that we only have the square with the side of 1 and the diagonal of X. So, you can calculate this in just a couple of seconds. You can say that the diagonal is equal to the side times square root of 2, which means that the diagonal of the square is equal to square root of 2, and this is our solution for X. Well, some of you are going to enjoy this method, some of you are going to hate this method, and it's all good. That's why I leave multiple methods so that everyone can be happy, if that's even possible. So, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please do not hesitate to leave a like or subscribe to the channel. Of course, leave your own method if you found another way to solve this problem. And until next time, see you all and take care.